Arnie, good morning. Today we have some special programming.
As many of our listeners know, John Engen, long-term mayor of Missoula, died on August 15th. And we were lucky enough over the past 6 years or so to have him on our show many times as a guest. And we're going to use the next couple of weeks to share with our listeners again the comments, thoughts, and life of John Engen.
This is Scott Richmond.
And Arnie Sherman.
You're listening to What Do You Know on News Talk KGVO, AM 1290 and 98.3 FM. Arnie, good morning.
And how are you, Scott, after this eventful week?
I'm feeling good. I'm feisty.
Feisty, that's good. It's good to be feisty. We're going to have the mayor on the show this week, and we'll be able to talk to him about his running for a fourth term.
Yeah.
And we'll also be able to ask him about some of the things that his opponent brought up last week, Lisa Tripke, about why she's running and her vision of the city. And that'll all be very interesting. And we've had a very highly visible week here in Montana.
I'm impressed, Arnie, that we are kind of at the center of where the political elite meet.
Well, for the wrong reasons. You know, I've said a long time, we've tried to stay away from politics, but it's clear that the sort of Trump culture has put civility and statesmanship in the back seat of the American political vehicle. You know, there's this toxic, and this is my opinion, you know, so this toxic masculinity that has become pervasive since Trump has encouraged, you know, lots of folks to come out and be, you know, inappropriate in many instances.
Right.
You know, be misogynistic, you know, be, you know, homophobic. I mean, all those instincts that has never been once.
Islamophobic.
Islamophobic. There has not been one, instance that I can recall of the president speaking out and saying, that's enough. You know, this was all campaign talk and I got elected. Now let's curtail this and try to be one, you know, one country, indivisible.
Right.
You know, it's still the, you know, pushing of that. This past week, the president, chastised NATO and said that Germany was very, very evil for selling their cars in America, and he's going to do something about it. I mean, he is really creating a new reality that is not based on, you know, principles of diplomacy, decorum,
right,
and you know, really statesmanship, and it's very unsettling to a lot of people. And this is not just a Democratic or, you know, liberal issue. This is an issue of governance and Americans' leadership in the world and trying to take on a position of moral compass. And we've lost that somehow.
Politics has become a blood sport,
right? You know, a total blood sport. You know, we had that situation this past week here where our candidate at the time for office, Gianforte,
right,
body slammed a reporter,
broke his glasses,
and was found by, you know, the police department to be charged with a misdemeanor assault, you know, which is unheard of in politics at this point in time.
Right.
I do have to say, historically, this is not, there have been times where this has come and, you know, waxed and waned in American politics. And a good friend of mine, Larry Harrington, who is a former congressional staffer and a student of American history, reminded me today about Preston Billy Brooks.
Who is he?
Preston Billy Brooks. He was a U.S. congressman from South Carolina who on May 22nd of 1856, so this is a long time ago,
right?
This is 170 something years ago. Was a states' right advocate and a slavery advocate, and there was a congressional session going on in which a senator, Charles Sumner, was speaking. Was an abolitionist and speaking out, you know, against slavery and against states' rights and being one nation under God, indivisible.
Yes,
and Preston went, caned this guy on the floor of the legislature to the point that Sumner couldn't serve for 3 years. It took him 3 years to recuperate from the beating that Bully Brooks gave to him. Brooks then stepped down out of office to see whether what the effect, and his constituents reelected him to office after that. Yes, after that incident.
Why was that?
Well, because they believed in states' rights and, you know, South Carolina and slavery, and they were opposed to the abolition.
Right.
It was a North-South issue, just as, you know, we're having to some extent now. I mean, there's great resentment to Confederate, you know, monuments been taken down, and you know there is a lot of anxiousness, and I think some of it has to do very clearly with, for better or worse, 8 years of Obama presidency.
Right.
I think it created a tremendous amount of anxiety around for white middle class people in the country, particularly in the South and other places, more poorly educated whites. Whites who were working class, 8 years of the presidency gave them great anxiety that their stature and status in the American hierarchy was under threat.
Right.
And, reacted strongly to that. That wasn't the intention, but it was the unintended consequence of, you know, of a two-term black president in the United States creating tremendous anxiety, and Trump fed right into that anxiety. Not that we're going to talk to the mayor about that today, but I think given what's happened in this past week and given, you know, some of the things that are happening around the world, I think it's important to not forget the milieu in which we're operating in.
I agree. I look forward to it. I look forward to bringing Mayor Engen in. You are listening to What Do You Know on News Talk KGVO, proudly supported by Don Maddox, Glacier Sotheby's International Realty. Arnie and I will be back after this with Mayor Engen. We are back with Mayor Engen.
Mayor, welcome.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
It's good to have you. Last week, as you probably know, we had Lisa Tripke on the show. She is an announced candidate for mayor and talked about her vision for Missoula and why she was running for office. In fact, she said one of the reasons she was running was she heard you a couple of months earlier on our show, and that led to her. So I don't know if I want to pat herself on the back or apologize to you, but she said that listening to our show encouraged her to run for office. So I thought what we do today is to kind of share some of the issues that she felt compelled her to enter the race against you, and see how you would respond to those questions. Does that seem fair?
Fair enough.
Even if it's not fair, we're going to do it anyway.
And
because
you can color outside of the lines too, by the way.
That's right. That's
you like
right.
That.
That's right. So one of the things that's come up, and we've talked about it on our shows before, is mountain water. And I think the issue that she says that voters are concerned about, it started out maybe as was going to be a small number associated with it. I think she even threw out the number $800,000 at one time, and now I think next week we're going to settle for $96 million. So the question is that if you knew that at the beginning, would you still have done the acquisition? Would the city still have moved in the direction it did, and how it did?
Absolutely, and that's a question I've asked myself. This has been a long, difficult, challenging journey. But the fact of the matter is that there would not be another opportunity for the city of Missoula, the only municipality in the state of Montana that does not own and operate its water system, to do so. What we're finding nationally is that these utilities are cash cows. And so private investment right. groups from lots of other places view these as cash cows. So
right.
they move in, they buy. They extract as much as they can in terms of profit. They don't reinvest in the systems, and ratepayers, taxpayers, citizens are left holding the bag for systems that become decrepit. Over the long haul, I think that I will likely do nothing more important in my career as mayor than the acquisition of this water company, and I'd do it again today. The notion that it was ever going to cost $800,000, that might have been one of the estimates for legal bills, acquisition costs. We blew through that very quickly. I will own that all day long. The fact of the matter is that we had a giant hedge fund opposite us, and they made it their mission to make this as expensive a transaction as they possibly could. That's not a reason to give up the fight.
Right.
That's not a reason not to pursue acquisition. And ultimately, the reason we're acquiring this utility is because we can charge less, reinvest in the system, and ensure that Missoulians have safe water for a very long time.
Water rates going to go down, or are they going to just be less than they would have been without the city involvement?
Increases will be less than they would have been.
Right.
And any increase that comes from rate goes directly into the system. So we operate this as an enterprise fund, much in the same way we operate the sewer system. So every nickel that goes into operating the water system goes into the salaries of employees. It goes into capital expenses. So we have got about $100 million worth of improvements, deferred maintenance in this system. Ain't nobody going to do that but the city of Missoula, because Carlisle, as you may remember, had anticipated in front of their in their rate case in front of the Montana Public Service Commission a 5% year-over-year rate increase, and that wasn't to address deferred maintenance in the system. That was to ensure that investors were made rich.
Is there an example of the Carlisle Group or others like that shutting down municipalities and, like, to your point, making it too expensive for them to pursue it? And are there examples of that you were looking at along the way and saying, why did they fold?
Sure. There are attorneys in the United States who make a living by defending private utilities against condemnation actions. And in some cases and in some jurisdictions, they're successful. Mm-hmm. It either gets too expensive or, frankly, they have courts and judicial systems in those jurisdictions that don't view the essential necessity of water the way Montana courts do.
Right.
So under your leadership, we've acquiring the water system that was Mountain Water. You've got into the composting business. There is now Missoula City Cemetery. There are some voters out there that are saying this is city overreach, that the city's getting involved in private enterprise, and that was not the intention, you know, of city government. How do you respond to that?
So municipal government does some things very well, and it does some things poorly. And in cases where there is opportunity to serve the public, where the private sector is not going to engage in a way that's going to meet those public needs, that's where we step in. So the case of EcoCompost, we had in this case, a willing seller who was looking to get out of the business, who had stopped making additional investment in that business. There were odor issues, there were fire issues, and we began a friendly dialogue about how we might be able to get into that business. The fact of the matter is that composting is waste management, and municipalities all around the country deal in both solid and liquid waste. We have a wastewater utility here. We don't do solid waste. But the fact of the matter is that we can operate this facility at a nonprofit rate, and in doing so, we can improve the quality of the facility. We can improve municipal operations. We make a lot of compost, right? We create a lot of waste.
Yeah, 70,000 people create a lot of waste,
right? And so this is a way that we extend the life of a landfill. We reuse the raw materials that come from yard waste, and it mixes, as it turns out, really well with human waste. And we have been tipping over tons and tons of
human waste,
processed human waste that goes into this composting utility. And we've been paying roughly $400,000 a year to tip that stuff over the fence. Today, we incorporate that into this operation, and the community is better for it. Nobody was going to step in to do this. There weren't people clamoring to buy EcoCompost and operate it.
Yeah, no. Our guest is Mayor John Engen. You're listening to What Do You Know on News Talk KGVO. Our proud sponsor, or we are proudly sponsored by Don Maddox Glacier Sotheby's International Realty. Arnie?
So how come we're in the Missoula City Cemetery business?
We were in the cemetery business long before anyone in this room walked the earth. The cemetery's been there forever, and if you ever happen to step out there and look at some of those old headstones, you'll note that They predate my tenure as mayor, and there are a number of mayors buried out there. Municipal cemeteries have been a thing for many communities for many years. It is far from a profit center. The fact of the matter is that the city subsidizes that cemetery to the tune of roughly $800,000 a year, give or take.
Wow.
That's certainly $800,000 a year that we could use elsewhere, but it turns out there aren't many buyers for cemeteries. And we also...
People aren't dying to get in?
Good joke.
Arnie's here all week, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, that's right.
Don't forget your wait staff. And the fact of the matter is that that citizens have a clear attachment, as you will see on Monday, to this cemetery. That cemetery will be highly decorated. There are lots of folks who visit the remains of their loved ones. There's considerable history out there. If someone said to me, why don't you start a cemetery today? My answer would be no.
Right. Right.
An above ground mausoleum, maybe.
Sure. All right. The tough issue that we all deal with is, which is potholes. What's the status of Missoula potholes? There's always, grumblings and, you've talked about that before, but are we improving?
We are improving. We are
we had a tough winter.
We did. In this mountain community, we are subject to weather, and we could reconstruct every street in the city of Missoula at an expense that would crush taxpayers and citizens. And what we do instead of that is we do triage. So every year we have a street repair program, and we invest. Municipal budgeting is a function of finding balance, and we ensure that streets are safe and passable. They are not always smooth and not always without inconvenience, but we're filling. We probably filled 600 potholes this year easily. And unless we come up with a technology that allows us to stop winter, completely seal roads, we're always going to have potholes. One of the things that we are doing is, as a function of this budget year, we're doing a full streets inventory so that we have a plan for addressing street needs. But I can tell you, based on back of napkin estimates, as we were at the legislature talking about infrastructure improvements, this session, we have probably an 80-year backlog of street repairs to do. We probably have funding for 10 years of that. So we
that
are
right.
Yeah, I mean, we're always going to be catching up. The more resources we invest in street reconstruction, the more we get done.
Are there any other elements of the infrastructure of this town that have been neglected that we need to address in the next term, in the coming years,
right?
Because that's what people always get. They always feel like they're being caught off guard. I didn't know we needed that, but hey, they didn't know they needed it because they didn't think about it.
Right. You're finishing up your third term.
Right.
You're running for a fourth term. What are those things that you want to accomplish during that fourth term?
Well, in the large picture, we continue to have a housing problem in Missoula. There are lots of folks who, A, can't afford housing, B, if they're in a position to buy a home, they can't come up with a down payment. There are folks who simply can't afford first and last month's rent. For me, this is largely an inventory problem. So we've been working with the Missoula Organization of Realtors, Missoula Economic Partnership, on an inventory, a study of what the market looks like, what the opportunities are. I've had probably three fairly productive meetings with developers in the last 3 weeks about how we begin to significantly move the needle on affordable housing. And for me, affordable housing is soup to nuts. The inventory is low income housing to folks who are looking to to purchase a single family home on a big lot. We don't have enough of any of it.
Right.
And so addressing those inventory issues is critical.
But isn't the real issue, at least from my perspective, you know, how build construction costs what construction costs. It's not going down. It's going up
right.
per square foot. I know that from the work that we're involved in outside of this studio. And our, you know, median income in Missoula is pretty flat. I mean, this year, the median home price is $265,000, and the median household income is $43,000 a year. You know, and that's a huge issue to overcome. So what do we do about getting, you know, salaries and wages, you know, up?
So we created in 2010 at sort of the height of the recession for Missoula. We created the Missoula Economic Partnership. We put business leaders throughout the community together in a room. We created a strategy for growing the economy, creating jobs, creating opportunities for people to create jobs, and really driving wage. And our efforts have concentrated on working with companies and creating opportunities for jobs that we consider a living wage, $15 and better in Missoula. And we've had some success. There are more people working today in Missoula than have ever been working. There are some market pressures around wages as well.
Some companies want to move here because they can pay less than where they are. I mean, that's reality.
Some do. Some also find that our regulatory environment is more attractive. Some find that that our building environment is more attractive. Some find that our quality of life is more attractive. And if you can live anywhere, why not live here and do what you're doing? I don't think there's a ton of negative wage pressure from folks coming in here because we're at a race to the bottom, right? We don't incentivize people to come in, pay low wages, offer tax breaks. Only to have the next community 2 years later say, I've got a better weed lot for you, and I've got a better tax break for you, and pack your bags and come see us. We don't engage in economic development that way. And I think the long-term picture for Missoula, given the fact that we're one of the best cities in the country for entrepreneurs, we're one of the best cities in the country for tech startups, the future's bright. What isn't going to happen is, in my opinion, what's not going to happen is we're not going to land a whale. Oracle isn't going to come here, nor is Cisco. But these small shops that create a diverse economy and a wage base are going to make a more significant long-term and sustainable difference.
Right, sure. And this is not an uncommon problem in any community this size across the country.
There are not many uncommon problems around the country.
No, I was just in Santa Barbara, a city that's not much bigger than Missoula. It has UC Santa Barbara. The median home price is $900,000 there.
Right.
The median wage is $70,000 or $80,000. I mean, it's not an uncommon problem.
Right.
It's just that when you're living here, you know, you as you watch how home and apartment rental prices keep going up and wages really not keeping up with it, there is the feeling that somebody should do something about it.
Absolutely, and that's why we do something about
it. Right.
That's why we're attempting to address inventory and opportunity. That's why we work pretty diligently with our partners in the private sector to ensure that Missoula's a good place to do business, that it's that you're not bogged down in red tape, that you're not looking for quality employees. We blew up the Office of Planning and Grants after 30 years of criticism to ensure that we had a development department that was all about facilitating quality development. And so last year we had a record year in new development in the city of Missoula, and we're on track to beat that record this year.
So with that development comes improvements to the infrastructure of the town, right? So that
correct.
What are those? Talk a little bit about that.
Well, so with almost any project, whether it's greenfield development or urban renewal, facilities are improved. So whether it's streets, sidewalks, sewer, water, utilities, the list goes on.
Technology.
When we are partners in projects through our urban renewal districts, We tend to improve transportation systems. We tend to create public spaces. We tend to operate in a way that's good for business and good for the public. And I don't think those two are mutually exclusive.
Well, let me get back to something we touched on earlier. We just finished up our biennial legislative session. How do we fare in terms of what we need, needed from the state?
So we do a couple of things at every legislative session. One is we endeavor to promote legislation that increases revenue sources for local governments and ensures that local decisions are honored. And whenever possible, we make critical decisions about the way our community evolves locally. So a couple of positive notes. One is that City of Missoula and the League of Cities and Towns, of which we're a part, participated in what was called the Infrastructure Coalition. So this was a group of private and public sector folks who got together to make a fact-based and evidence-based case for infrastructure investment in the state of Montana. That coalition was successful in passing an 8-cent gas tax in the state of Montana, first time it's been increased in decades, and that will go to roads. So when we get back to the question of potholes, the only way things improve dramatically is through new money, and there is new money now. So for fiscal year 18, which we're budgeting for now, that gas tax, we estimate, will deliver another $800,000 to $900,000 in money that we can use to put directly on the street, and it's discrete. It's for that type of infrastructure.
And how much will the county get outside of?
Yeah, I don't even know the county's number.
Right.
Next year we're projecting about $1.2 million of new money that's available for us to invest in transportation infrastructure. It's a big deal. Roads and bridges, right? So that was a victory. We didn't get an infrastructure bonding bill. That was a defeat. So there's a lot of work that does not get done around the state. There are a lot of people who don't get put to work, and there's a lot of infrastructure that doesn't get fixed or built. We also during the course of the last session beat back attacks on what really is the single most powerful tool that cities and counties have in the state of Montana to drive economic development. That's tax increment financing. That's the tool that will help build the Riverfront Triangle. It's a tool that's helping build student housing downtown. It's a tool that will help rebuild on the site of the Mercantile. It's the tool that we use to revitalize what's now called South Crossing, where the old Kmart was. It's the tool that we'll use as we work with Consumer Direct, which is a pretty spectacular building in a really interesting business that employs hundreds of folks here in Missoula. And
it's a healthcare. It's home healthcare.
Yep, and thousands around the country. They've elected to have their headquarters
here in Missoula.
Right. You touched on the university. Let's get back to I'd like to focus in on that a little. We have declining enrollment, which puts some pressure on student housing and other housing in the area and revenue to merchants in town. It's the fate of this city and the university system is, you know, interwoven. You can't deny the yin and yang of all of that. What can the city do to be, proactive in increasing the viability of Missoula as a university town?
Yeah. So not only do we not deny that relationship, I think it's incumbent upon us to embrace it. I think we've done a good job of that over the years. So we continue to work hand in glove with the university on programs ranging from our work with Missoula College, which is also in a redevelopment district, to having conversations with the new vice president for enrollment, Tom Crady, about how we recruit and attract students, how we ensure that that this is a safe and interesting community for them. And we've begun preliminary conversations about how we can make a two-year college, which is a stepping stone to the University of Montana, attainable for every citizen. And the more we can fill that enrollment pipeline, I think the better off we'll be. So those conversations are ongoing. We also have conversations about things as simple as transportation, things as complex as sexual assault, and those relationships can only grow. I have the good fortune of being on a search committee for the new University of Montana president. My hope is that whoever finds themselves in what I think is a challenging but incredibly cool job filled with opportunities embraces the relationship that exists and works to further that relationship. There is so much that we can do together, ranging from planning, you know, the constraints of the university campus.
It's only 225 acres and you got a mountain in the way.
And we have some invisible lines there, right?
Right,
we have folks who aren't necessarily crossing Arthur either way,
right?
Or crossing the river either way,
right?
And really the assets and the talent of the University of Montana, I want those folks out in our community making lives better, and in doing so, they are enriched themselves.
Let's do a quick ID. Our guest is Mayor John Engen. You are listening to What Do You Know? Are proudly supported by Don Maddox, Glacier Sotheby's International Realty.
So you have some things that hamstring you in terms of budgetary control or constraints.
Yep.
You have, union contracts for raises. I was startled, actually, to find, and this may be wrong, and you can correct me, that the average wage of a patrolman on the street here is $10,000 or $12,000 less than it is in Bozeman and Billings.
Yeah, that gap should actually be a lot closer. We're actually closer to the top of the market now. So when I was first elected and began serving in 2006, our officers were among the lowest paid.
Right.
And at that time, we were basically investing in a training program. We were subsidizing a training program, mm-hmm, for officers to go
to other cities
across the street, yeah, or to other cities.
Right.
And so we were very aggressive. We negotiated a contract with the police association that allowed for us to get to a market rate. So today, when we do recruitment, we have pools of qualified candidates, and we have folks who want to stick around. And it takes 3 or 5 years to become kind of seasoned and comfortable as a patrol officer.
Do we have enough on the people on the street, young, you know, men and women in the patrol force on the street?
You know, we can always have more, but again,
right,
my job is about striking a balance. So today we have just north of 100 sworn officers who serve the community. We operate in shifts 24/7, 365 days a year, and we're always looking at ways to improve the effectiveness of our officers on the street, through training, through technology,
you know, and that for a town of 70,000, that might sound enough, except when there's a Grizz football game, a concert going on in town,
yeah,
the, you know, a festival somewhere, the
right,
testicle festival going on. It's a pretty, it's a pretty thin cadre at that on a day like that.
Well,
it's
a special day.
Yeah,
it's a special day.
Yeah, and for us, you know, so we refer to the run of the mill. I dial 911 because I have an issue. That's a call for,
right,
service, right? So,
right,
so our calls for service increase year over year. Interestingly, crime, per se, violent crime in particular, kind of generally flat in Missoula,
uh-huh,
but calls for service. It's, you know, somebody's speeding, somebody's, you know,
some meth addict sleeping,
right,
in a car outside
neighborhood
my house.
Disputes, all that stuff.
Or how about things like the opioid epidemic, right? That's going every town, everywhere.
Right.
You know, how does that impact us? Like, what's happening here, and what are we doing to kind of address that?
Oh, it's a big deal, and addiction in general is a big deal,
right?
Opioids are certainly a thing. Heroin is a thing in Missoula. And, you know, because I work every day with police officers, those folks see kind of the dark underbelly of Missoula,
right.
the stuff that you and I don't generally see. There are a lot of people suffering out there. They have friends and family who are suffering as a function of those addictions. And there are folks who are profiting from those addictions.
Mm-hmm.
The problem at some level, like many problems that we deal with as a nation and as a state and as a city, can seem intractable. But we have, I think, opportunities on the enforcement side. So we participate in a local task force along with Missoula County, the state and the feds, around drug trafficking. Those officers are committed to those efforts. And occasionally we catch somebody who's bringing the stuff into the community in volume, right?
Yeah.
And so there's an availability piece that's an issue. But there's also a treatment piece that's an issue. There are a lot of folks who don't wake up one day and say, boy, I want to be an addict in the worst
way. I really need some heroin today.
Right, right. Yeah. It's so what we need to do in the community and what we try to do in this community is address causes. And those causes range from something as simple as a kid who isn't getting loved or touched in a home, to a kid who's getting abused, to a kid who doesn't have a place to sleep.
Right.
And we need to address those fundamental issues as well as deal with the enforcement side. And you see the enforcement side, the stories of untreated addicts do not end well.
Right, no, they don't. Let me bring up the issue of homelessness. We are one of the cities in Montana that sit right by an interstate, and that's a good feeder for, you know, homeless people or folks that want to hop off and somebody drops them here. And what is the status of homelessness in Missoula?
So,
is it growing? Is it controllable? Is Poverello Center enough?
Yeah. So like everywhere, homelessness is on the rise because of poverty and addiction. And again, these seemingly unsolvable social problems have some solutions, and we steal ideas from other communities. I got no problem with that. And and what we've seen in places like Salt Lake City, for example, where the community has invested in facilities that house people no matter their circumstance, right? So housing does not need to be for everyone, does not need to be, you know, a 2,500 square foot house, a rancher on a 10,000 square foot lot. For some folks, it's single room occupancy, but they're no longer sleeping on the street. And when you're not sleeping on the street, there's some stuff that starts to happen to your life, right?
Right.
You, A, don't have to figure out where you're going to sleep every night. You're not necessarily subject to violence. You're not necessarily subject to the whims of weather. And so what Salt Lake has done is figured out a way to house people first and then start to deal with the other issues that they're dealing with. It's really hard to fix somebody if they don't have someplace stable to live.
Right. They're the Maslow hierarchy of needs. I mean, their basic needs aren't being met, and they have to deal with that before they can deal with anything else. And it also leads to petty theft and all those other sorts of things.
Yeah, so what we have done is created a 10-year plan to end homelessness. Shocking that we haven't solved it 6 years into it.
But it's important for a town like Missoula because we're a tourist destination, and nobody feels particularly comfortable if there are 40 people wandering around downtown panhandling for money.
However, I will tell you that having spent 3 days in Seattle last week.
Yeah, worse.
Yeah, it's not just here.
No,
and it's everywhere. And so the issue becomes, do we throw our hands up and say, it ain't fixable, so we ain't going to try? We are all about trying.
Right.
And
you can't just lock them up in jail.
Right. Well, and frankly, our options today are jail or the emergency room. And both of those are far more expensive than trying to address housing first.
You bring up a good point, Arnie. We have tourism is a big business for us. It's only getting more important. Recreation, we have the riches here, right, with respect mm-hmm. to recreation. Mm-hmm. One of the things I'm curious about is the river, because the river is just such, is the lifeblood, is an artery for a major metropolitan area. And I seem to, my feeling is that it may not, it's been neglected a little bit. It has not necessarily
received. We don't have a river walk like they do in in San Antonio.
Right, but everywhere that you and I have been and you've been, John, you know that the river is the lifeblood, if you will, of the city. What are we doing to kind of make improvements there and address that?
Sure. So I will tell you, in my 57th year living in, or 52nd rather. Wow.
Wow.
Age yourself.
In my 52nd year living here in Missoula, the river has always been an artery, but for a long time it was an artery clogged with plaque, right?
Right.
And only by virtue of the work that people have done over the last 3-4 decades has the riverfront improved to the degree that it has. So when I was a kid, there were no trails along the riverfront. Every building turned its back to the riverfront. If you were fishing in the Clark Fork River in downtown Missoula, you were a fool,
right?
Because there was no reason to be doing that. So through the good work of a lot of people, the riverfront is really, we consider it a destination. We also consider it a focal point for development and for public spaces. So you can walk along the banks of the Clark Fork River today, ride your bike,
go to Silver Park,
roll in your wheelchair, and you don't need to touch a public street for a long way to do that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We continue to look a river that can be loved a bit too much. So we have, rogue river access. The river through downtown Missoula is not the meandering channel that nature created. It's constrained by it's constrained by levees all day long.
Right.
And you'll see some places where those levees are old concrete riprap that's been, we used to treat the river like a dump. So we've made a lot of progress. There's more progress to be made. Good.
And there are some plans to put restaurants over the next few years along the river. So
our riverfront trail system will continue to expand. Anywhere you see a surface parking lot along the banks of the Clark Fork River is a prime opportunity for redevelopment. We continue to talk about that. The riverfront is a much nicer place than it was when I was a kid, and it just gets better.
And clean water, I think, is also important.
Right, absolutely. Exactly. So we mentioned earlier, you're running for a fourth term.
I am indeed.
You are?
Yes. Lisa Tripke on the show last week said she was going to be an advocate for term limits, two 4-year terms. And she said if she was elected, she would not serve more than 2 terms. What's your thoughts on term limits for mayor?
We have them.
Right?
Right. And it's a pretty simple program.
I know where you're going.
I wear the voters out or they wear me out.
Right.
And so we have seen the consequences of term limits in the state legislature. Every session, a ton of those people have to be completely educated in what goes on and how to govern. There is something to be said for experience. I don't, this mayor for life business is not, I don't intend to be mayor for life. I intend to be mayor as long as I have fire in the belly for the job, vision, I'm competent, and voters agree with that. I am glad that voters have a choice here,
mm-hmm.
and I get to discuss my record, the work that I have done with a team of remarkably talented folks and committed citizens. I'm happy to talk about my vision for the future, a place where commerce can thrive because we invest in infrastructure, both green and concrete, where we where we work together to solve these problems that we sometimes describe is intractable. So during the course of my service as mayor, it's the stuff that you don't know that's coming that that puts you to the test.
Sure.
I had zero intention of attempting to acquire a water company, but opportunity presented itself, and it was an opportunity that that a responsible person could not pass up.
Right.
When I was negotiating with the U.S. Department of Justice around a civil rights complaint, we could have done one of two things. We could have said, we have no problems here, and you go ahead and take us to court, and we could have been in the position that other communities under similar circumstances found themselves, which is under a consent decree that was enormously expensive and had social costs for the community, or we could reach an agreement that made us better, and that's what we did. This is a place where people are committed, they're passionate, and they want more. And so part of my job is to understand how we make more things happen, how we meet as many interests as we possibly can while continuing to do the nuts and bolts stuff that we do every day.
Let me ask you from a bigger picture question.
Yeah.
You got 12 city council members. You have advisory boards and commissions. You have a city manager. You have voters out there. You have 500 or 600 employees, hundreds, you know, officers. You have a big, public safety. You know, what do you think your strength is in, you know, orchestrating this? You're the maestro of all of this. What do you think your strength is, and what do you think is the area that you find the most challenging?
So this job is fundamentally about leadership and vision and risk-taking and deciding things. And fundamentally, sometimes you're right, even when popular opinion in the beginning suggests you're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And there have been a number of cases where we've had to sort through that. And at the end of the day, you have to be committed to principle and you have to be committed to vision, because otherwise nothing will change. If I were to judge the state of our community by the comments we receive on Monday evenings at council meetings, I think we lived in a fairly terrible place.
Right.
But the fact of the matter is that when I visit with the fisheries convention that's in the biologist convention that's in Missoula today, and they're out for the fun run, they are grooving on that.
Right.
They're here for a reason, and they recognize the value of the community. One of the things that can happen to us is we forget how good we have it. I remind myself pretty regularly that probably 99% of the world's population would love to live in Missoula, Montana.
Right.
And I take that responsibility for being a steward pretty seriously.
How do you juggle the interests of the citizens, of the folks at the city, at the council meetings on Monday nights, and some of the bigger private companies that make Missoula their home and their interests, like the Washington Company or the hospital or the university?
Well,
because they sometimes are diametrically opposed.
Oddly enough, we find so many things in common in terms of the way we work together. So, for example, over the course of a fairly long and quiet negotiation, we purchased a piece of property from Montana Rail Link, a Washington Corporation subsidiary, that will become a neighborhood park and be redeveloped, we hope, over time into housing and mixed use and commercial. And this is a lot that needed redevelopment. I have a terrific relationship with the folks at the Washington Corporation, and because we can talk and because they have they've seen me be reasonable, they've seen me do the things that I've said I would do. They've seen me recognize that these are partnerships and not handouts. That level of trust and credibility allows us to get stuff done.
Right.
So we can work with these large institutions all day long to accomplish things because we've established a level of trust and credibility.
One of the other things that you hear, you know, on a regular basis, it was brought up last week, is the issue of transparency.
Yeah.
You know,
thank you, Mayor Engen.
It's always a pleasure to have you here and give us a big picture look at things. We'd like to have you come back on again as we get further into the election season and query you on more specifics.
Happy to do it. Thank you for your thoughtful questions. I always enjoy these conversations.
As do we. Thank you.
See you next week,
Arnie. See you next week, Scott.
Thank you for listening to What Do You Know?
I can't wait for the next show, Scott.
I'm excited too, Arnie. If you'd like to suggest a guest, send me an email at scottrichman@townsquaremedia.com. We'll see you next week. And thanks for listening to News Talk KGVO, AM 1290, 101.5 FM, and newstalkkgvo.com.